Hi, Dr. Lori here. I want to talk with you about plates and dishes because we all have a lot of china, a lot of dinnerware, a lot of plates and dishes. You know, they're in the storage locker, they're in the basement, they're in the cabinet, they're in the china closet, they're all over the place. I've got grandma's, I've got Aunt Susie's, I've got this one, I have my own that I bought, all of it. So a lot of people ask me about what do I look for? And you know, many times you've heard me at my events say, oh, you know, look for the brighter, whiter clay, right? The brighter and whiter the clay is, the higher the purity quality, the better the ceramic it is, as it, of course, is pure and used in the kiln and so forth. Okay, we know those types of things. But there are specific things that I want you to learn about plates and dishes, because we all have so many, that will impact value. So if you're in a thrift shop, if you're in a yard sale, if you're at an estate sale, and it doesn't say Limoges, and everyone goes, oh, Limoges, you know, it doesn't say that. What do you do, right? So what are we really looking for? Yes, marks matter, sure, but marks are not the only thing that matters. So I want you to think about all of these other aspects of plates and dishes that will help you to identify something of quality, right? Now, sometimes it goes by period. You know, what does that mean, Dr. Lori? Well, that basically means if it's of a style, right, of a particular time period or of a style. Certain plates from certain time periods look different from other plates. This plate is a Lindt Steinmeist plate. It's from the 1990s. It's been discontinued because I hate to admit it, the 1990s is how many decades ago now, right? So this plate is very typical of the 90s, right? Bright colors and sort of like a fun pop of color for even a dinner party that might be a little bit more informal. That's what this plate is. So now that they are discontinued, they're worth a little bit more than they were in 1992 or 1993 when you could have purchased them from your favorite store. Okay. Those kinds of plates are looking like that, and that's pretty typical. Some of the things you might identify when you see a younger plate, and I hate to say that a plate from the 1990s is younger, the color is continued on the back. So you've got the color in the back and the color on the front, and the glaze is, of course, continued front and back. Okay, so that makes sense because you've got glaze continued front and back. Well, that's one of the tips. Not the only tip, but that might help you identify a plate that is a little bit younger than your typical, oh, I'm looking at grandma's plates from the late 1800s, early 1900s, or the war years, the 40s through the 60s, let's say. Okay, so that's one of the things. So I'm going to compare, here's the 1990s era plate, and here's a Blue Ridge plate. You're saying, a Blue Ridge plate? Yeah, Blue Ridge, very, very common. You all know it, right? You know it from the mark, and you probably would identify it for a couple of characteristics. This is a typical post-war era plate, right? Blue Ridge, American-made. This happens to be my Aunt Dorothy's plate. And you're saying your Aunt Dorothy? Yeah, my Aunt Dorothy, my family, you know, Italian Catholics, Connecticut, everybody served in the war. I always tell you, you know, everybody was old and I was the only young one. Well, this particular piece is a typical plate. Now, they weren't of particular wealth, right? So this was your typical average plate that most people who weren't of particular wealth could afford, right? Now, there are a couple things about this plate that make it kind of special. Now, today, of course, it's special to me for sentimental value and such. You know, we had Christmas dinner on these plates. So these are my holiday plates growing up. You're thinking, wow, they really didn't have any kind of cash. Well, that's true. So anyway, but for the most part, what you're looking at here is you're looking at a pretty typical mid-20th century plate. And it looks like it's hand-painted. You're saying, is it hand-painted? Well, basically, one of the things you want to look for with any plate, and it doesn't matter if it's an American plate, I want you to look for hand-painting. I don't want you to look for the mechanization, right, of course, machine-made or mass-produced plates, okay? I want you to look for hand-painting and be able to identify it because, you know, your hand will move differently than a machine. The machine will always make it right, right? It'll always be the same. That's not true when it comes to hand painting. So elements that look like you can identify the brush strokes, and you can see brush stroke or brush work or hand work, is typical on this particular plate. Oh, tulips, you know, I always talk about flower forms and what they relate to, and tulips happen to be prosperity, or roses mean love, or carnations mean fidelity and marriage, and blah, blah, blah. Okay, so those things have to do with how do you like to decorate and what particular flowers, designs, decorations are something that you like, and maybe you choose those when you're buying china. So this particular plate also has other elements, not only the hand-painted nature of it, which looks like, hey, someone relates to me, there's a human-to-human contact with this particular plate, but also this ridge and the shape of this ridge, which is something that made a relatively inexpensive plate in its day look pretty fancy because it had a ridge like this. So the perimeter or the edging or the banding around this particular plate is what makes it a little bit more special. But this plate is not as special as a more expensive plate like this one, which would in fact have gold banding, that gilt around the perimeter or the edge, or platinum banding. Wow, if you had platinum banding, or sterling silver banding, you can see the silver banding on this plate. Okay, so looking at the Blue Ridge piece, if I were to look at this piece, you'd turn it over and I would say to you, oh, look for the bright white clay. It's not all that bright white. All right. So there's your idea about we're looking at plates that are hand-painted typically, or they look like they're hand-painted. You know, for example, this plate. This particular plate here is spongeware. So literally, as if you took the sponge, you dipped it in paint. You remember third grade, they made you do all art projects. You dipped it and you go all the way around the perimeter of that particular plate to make the perimeter look fancy, with an emblem in the middle. So that's what this plate is, and it's called spongeware, with the flower in the middle and then the red spongeware all the way around the perimeter. Fine, if you come back to your Blue Ridge plate, you'll notice that this Blue Ridge plate, yeah, it has this decoration here that looks like it's brush strokes by hand, but in the center it's empty. That's where the food is gonna go, because you don't wanna have a plate, right, where you've got the food, of course, covering up a particular decoration in the center of the plate. What is that called? That's a cabinet plate. Cabinet plates have a decoration in the center, not always intended for you to put food in the middle of that plate and cover up the decoration. Originally, cabinet plates were intended to be up in the cabinet, and those plates were for decoration, or they were to decorate the table, and then when food was served, those plates actually go back into the cabinet, or they're taken off the table before food is served. So that's the difference between those types of plates. So you want to look for the difference. Some people will say, I only have six of these plates, Dr. Lori, and they've got this beautiful decoration in the middle of them. Well, those are cabinet plates, and they usually come in groups of six or 12, for example. Okay, so that's what you have with respect to this idea of spongeware, decorated edging, this kind of thing, on plates that would be, in fact, hand-painted. Some plates, many plates actually, are transferware. That's this plate. This particular plate is a transferware plate, and it differs, of course, from other plates. So transferware plates, this one happens to be a holiday transferware plate, are very, very typical, because basically what happens is the image here is repeated, mass-produced in large numbers, repeated, that image is transferred onto the ceramic and fired in the kiln, right? Or in somehow fired, attached to the ceramic. So this isn't painted on, and this isn't hand-painted. This actually, the applied ornament actually goes on just like a transfer. So think of a decal or a sticker, or think of a piece of paper that actually has a decoration on it that is then applied onto this plate, glazed over, and then refired in the kiln. These plates have to be very sturdy, and here's why. This plate has to go through the firing process more than one time. Right? So now you have to have that particular durability to these kinds of plates. Sometimes they're cabinet plates, right? This particular plate might go on a holiday table, and then before anybody sits down to eat anything, they get moved away. Oh, it looks pretty for when everybody shows up, but then they go away because you're not eating off this plate. Typically, transferware, because the image is transferred. Pretty simple. So that's what you have with that plate. You'll also notice with this plate is they've got this edging, which we talked about here with the Blue Ridge plate. Okay, so you've got that kind of thing. You've got this idea of trying to decorate the plate in some way without investing the money, investing the things to have actually, in fact, that idea of the gold perimeter banding or the silver or the platinum or such. All right, so that's what you're looking at there. Then, these are typical shaped plates, but then you have really interesting plates. Plates that date all the way back to Cantonese plates. Plates that we'll see, and china and dinnerware that we'll see, that maybe even George Washington might have been eating off of. So Cantonware plates are that blue-white china. A lot of people will tell me, oh my gosh, I can't tell you how many times I've met people who say, my dinnerware set is blue-white. It's Meissen. It's the onion pattern. It's, you know, it's blue and white and blue and white and blue and white. People love it. It's beautifully attractive, and a lot of people collect it. Blue white, Delft, Meissen, Dresden, many, many blue white patterns. Royal Copenhagen is probably one of the most famous. Actually dates back to the idea, of course, of folks in Canton, China, who are creating blue white porcelain, blue white china dinnerware for, in fact, the idea of having it be sold to a different market. So the Eastern market, right, the Asians are basically selling it to the Western market, or the Europeans and eventually the Americans. So this particular blue-white plate is a Cantonware plate. They're pretty popular, and then from these Cantonware patterns, those particular patterns then become, again, that idea of chinoiserie, looking Asian, or chin, Chinese. They're looking Asian, and then those particular plates are actually inform the decorations of, like, the Royal Copenhagens and the Meissens and others. But that blue-white color pair is the color pair that is repeated over and over again. So that's what we start with. We start with that idea of looking to Asia for our style, and then we move it into Europe, and then, of course, the rest of the West, including the United States. So that's what we're looking for with that idea of the very, very famous China patterns of the blue-white color pairs. The other things that I want you to think about is this idea of shape for a plate. The shape of a plate relates to the food that's going on the plate, right? So there's a reason why the bowl, of course, is a bowl, because you're going to put something that's soupy in it, right? And then I oftentimes talk to you about cracks and chips. I wanted to show you this crack because this particular piece, one of these days, if this particular piece gets utilized more, that piece is going to crack right in half because of that crack right down the middle. Over time, that particular crack weakens and weakens and weakens, and all of a sudden, boom, you don't have it anymore. So a crack is always worse than a chip because chips are easier to, they're usually at the surface, they're usually around the perimeter, they're easier to repair or of course conserve, versus of course a piece like this, which has a crack, which will of course make the whole body of the piece, the foundation of the piece, weaken. That's not what you want. But having said that, many times people say, we know, Dr. Lori, you know, cracks are worse than chips. We know, I know. But basically, I want you to think about those particular pieces. So be careful with those pieces. If you have a piece that's chipped or cracked, you might say to yourself, oh, all right, well, I can keep it because it's part of a set, and you should keep it because it's part of a set. You want to keep it if it's part of a set. But what you also want to do is take it out of commission, sort of out of use, right? Oh, it sits there and we have it, but we're not using it, because every time you use it, you're going to weaken it some more, right? So that's what we have with those particular type of plates. But when you look at shapes of plates, right, like oyster plates, we all know that oyster plates can range in value from $400 to, like, you know, $2,000. Oyster plates can be extremely valuable, and people do collect them. So oyster plates are, of course, they're shaped as if an oyster is going to sit in these little wells of the plate. All right. You might also have a plate that has sort of a rim, right, an edge that is circuitous. Basically, it's sort of formed. And that plate might be used for a different foodstuff. In addition to the form that looks like seafood, for example, there might be something that's actually painted or an image on the plate that tells you what you serve on these plates. Gaming plates, for example, when you're serving game. Or fish plates, for example, when you're, of course, serving fish. Those kinds of things. Of course, the shape of the plate, a larger platter, right, versus a smaller fruit bowl, for example, will be also something that you'll think about. And if there are ridges in your plate, right, that means that you might have something soupy, like maybe sometimes the juice from a fruit in a fruit salad. Or maybe you have something that's quite heavy that needs a lot of durability because you have to cut it, like a meat. Or an au jus well. You've probably seen those too. Having said that, when you're looking for value in plates, you also want to think about maker. Who made it, right? That's always important, and that's, of course, where the marks come in. And the marks are always important, but they're not the only thing. And I try to teach you to look at these other aspects, the foundation of the pieces, rather than just relying on marks. Because there's lots of marks by lots of manufacturers. They change the color of the mark, they change the time period of the mark, they change the style of the mark, and it might all impact value. Actually, it does all impact value. The other thing I want you to think about with respect to this is, in fact, where those manufacturers are. So here is a hand-painted, gilded, beautifully decorated, early 20th century Tiffany plate. This plate's gorgeous, okay? It's got the images of the birds, it's got gilding, a 22 karat banding, it's very beautiful. And on the back, you can see the beautiful bright white ceramic porcelain. You can also see Tiffany & Company. That means they made it. That mark is different from their distributor's mark. A mark where it says, well, we didn't make it, but in fact, we distributed it. So there's a difference, and you might see two marks. You might see a Theodore Haviland for Limoges mark on the back of a beautiful high-quality plate, and then it might say, made for, especially for, or made exclusively for Tiffany & Company, or R.H. Macy's, or whoever it might be in the distributor. So when you see these marks, don't automatically assume that a distributor's mark, marked on the back, is also the manufacturer's mark. That's where you got to do a little bit more research. Remember, colors of marks can be different, and also time periods. You can have the same china pattern, and you could have your great-great-grandmother collecting it, you could have your grandmother collecting it, you can have your mother collecting it, and you can collect it. The marks on the back of those plates are typically going to be a little bit different. So even if you have the same plate and you say, well, it's the whole same set, that set might be different. So you want to think about all of that. Having said that, I want to tell you a story about one of the great yard sale finds, the great thrift store finds, the great bargains that have to do with plates. This is a Benjamin Harrison plate. It relates to the 1892 Benjamin Harrison china set for the White House. Benjamin Harrison, like all of the presidents, would select, of course, china for the state service. So when heads of state would come, they would have a wonderful collection, a wonderful display of china. So this is Benjamin Harrison's plate. A person got in touch with me, right, one of my followers, and said, I found this plate, Dr. Lori. I found it at a yard sale. I paid $1 for it. She had no idea what the plate was, and she said, can you help me? And I said, I can help you. Your particular plate, I identified it as an 1892 President Benjamin Harrison plate, one of the dinner plates for his White House collection. And if you go to the White House, you can see all of the different plates. It's a beautiful example, the china services in those rooms. And basically, I said, you know what your plate's worth? It's worth $1,000. And I taught her how to sell it, and she sold it for $1,000. She was like, oh my gosh, Dr. Lori, I paid $1 for it. Don't let those pieces pass you by. Those pieces that you're finding at a yard sale or a flea market and you don't know what they are. Those particular pieces and many, many plates can be very valuable. I hope this little primer on plates and dishes will help you to identify not only by marks, but also by shape, by style, and by type, so you can spot that valuable plate or dish. I'm Dr. Lori. Thanks for tuning in.